Very strong for the markets. The Sensex is up almost 300 points right now, and the Nifty is 10. There's been a downgrade by Brickwork, and there's a lot of talks that Supertech is facing a cash crunch situation. Tell us what's happening on the ground in terms of liquidity and funding.
So the downgrade was not due to the totally any default or anything of that sort. This was due to a delay. And as per new RBI guidelines, even one day delay is considered as a default. So in theory, yes, but in practicality, it was not a default. Mm-hmm. About the liquidity situation, we have seen NBFCs coming back again in the market and started funding to the home loan buyers as well as to us. But they are still on the conservative side. But after talking to their managements, it seems like the situation is getting improved today. And what we have been assured by NBFCs that in next quarter we'll be back in the game again.
Okay, 1 minute, Mohit. We're just getting some details on GST returns. Remember, in September it was 1 trillion, 1 lakh crore. October collections, which are collected in November, at the moment I believe stand at 97,000 crore. They usually get revised upward a little as when the full month gets over, because some GST collections keep coming in. At the moment, standing at 97,000 crore is much better than the earlier average of 94,000-95,000 crore. If you can clock 1 lakh crore, it would be that much better. We may still be finally short because of the shortfall of the earlier months. But this is a very good number and should be another positive for the bond markets, which will mean extra borrowing from the government is not called for. And even capex may not have to be cut if they are able to record better GST collection. So that's important to keep on the table. It's a good macro number, especially if 97,000 crore gets revised upwards towards 1 lakh crore. Okay, Mohit. Just tell us, as Sonia was asking us, what is the situation on the ground? How much, first some numbers, how much is your total loan and how much of that is from NBFCs and HFCs?
See, the total loan of our group is 2,500 crores and about 50% of that is from NBFCs and HFC. Mm. And let me tell you again that all our loans are in good shape and regular state. So we are in very good shape, and lately, since last two quarters, our sales numbers has also increased drastically, as we are delivering almost 10,000 apartment units this year. Looking at that, our sales number has been increased, and all our accounts are in standard shape.
Okay. The view that we got from a couple of experts, Prop Equity, for example, told us that it's not really the ongoing projects, but it's the under construction projects that are under stress and not getting financing. What is your own percentage of under construction projects at the moment, and have you got enough funding, financing for that, and at what rate? I mean, is it much higher than before?
We as a group, we are doing 80,000 houses all across our projects, out of which we have already delivered 40,000. And out of these 40,000, we have delivered 25,000 in last 3 years only. Mm. And we are maintaining the same pace year by year. And this year also, as I said, we have targeted almost 10,000. We are nearly achieving the target this year also. Mm. And yes, most of the projects are under construction or near completion. And all of the projects are of at least our group are fully financial closed and fully funded by either NBFCs or banks. And our average lending rate would be near about 13-14% of our total portfolio. Yes, new funding is available at a higher cost, but as I said, our group portfolio has already been funded initially. So our average percentage is very much competitive than the current market scenario.
Okay, Mohit, we also hear from experts that although the funding would be closed for some of the under construction projects, the NBFCs are not forthcoming and they are not disbursing the last tranche of money, and some of the projects therefore are being taken over by bigger builders. Lock, stock and barrel. Have you had to approach any bigger builder or company to take over any of your projects?
No. In fact, we are the bigger builders here.
Okay.
We have taken over few of the stuck-up projects, and so there is no such situation that we are co-partnering or bringing in any partners.
Sure.
Okay, well, from what you're saying, it seems like there doesn't seem to be a problem anymore. So funding is coming in from NBFCs. Let's get another expert on board. Ghulam Zia of Knight Frank joins in. Ghulam, hi, morning. What are the numbers suggesting? I mean, has the situation improved on the ground at all, or is there still a big cash crunch?
Well, at least currently, it still is a status quo. The feelers that Mohit is talking about are around, that things are returning to normalcy. However, for it to really get back to the levels where it was, say, about a quarter or two back, is going to take some time. And in between, whatever two or three quarters will be lost will definitely be a dent on the overall market, overall sector, real estate sector. But having said that, another thing that has to be really kept in mind is that whatever said and done, the consumer demand or the consumption itself is not improving. So whatever debts, whether it is from NBFCs, HFCs or banks, etc., is only a part of your problem. The larger problem is actual consumption. So if I go by the numbers that Mohit is talking about, his own group is going to add, if it is about 10,000 units, the current inventory level of 100,000 units in NCR region, while it does not sound huge, but please understand the current absorption level. At that rate, you will take about 4 years to consume this, which means that we are not consuming more than 30,000 units a year in any case. So the problem, the larger problem is, how are we going to get the consumers back in the market? Because whatever funds that you have taken from, whether it's NBFCs or the others, to pay them back, you need actual consumption to begin at the ground level, which to me is much larger a concern than whether NBFCs are opening up their coffers again or not.
How do you react to that, Mohit? Because this is not just Ghulam. There were a series of experts whom we have had all of the last month who have been saying the same thing, that houses that are already constructed are not moving out. As well, this last mile funding also is not available. Can you tell us if any NBFC has stopped last mile funding? As well, whether you are sure of the demand for the 10,000 units that you have put on as finished projects?
See, last year demand of these houses were pretty low compared to what we have seen in last couple of quarters. And as I told, couple of quarters for us, not just for us, but for the industry has went very well. We have seen very good amount of growth in velocity of sales in throughout the industry. I agree with Ghulam that it is probably not enough to consume the kind of supplies there. I mean, it will take few quarters more to get to that speed of demand where it should be. But at least we have seen some improvement last couple of quarters. And yes, we have seen some conservative approach by these NBFCs in last couple of quarters. But as I said, NBFCs has started coming back in game. The home loans, the retail loans, which were also pretty slow last month, has already come back. People have started getting their disbursement. Customers have started getting their disbursement. So I would say I'll take it as a positive sign for the whole industry, and I'll see that. I can see that in next couple of quarters, things should improve. Should be improving and coming back to the normal.
We're getting divergent views from you.
We're getting different views. Yeah, Ghulam, can you put some numbers to what you just said? I mean, you said that inventory levels are very high, especially in NCR. What are they at the moment? And what is the quantum of total projects, under construction projects, that could be under stress because of funding constraints?
Well, it's much easier to answer your first question, but the later part will have to really go into a bit of a guesstimate. But nonetheless, to start with, the inventory levels in NCR today stand at about 100,000 units thereabouts. While that number itself is not too large, because at the same time, Mumbai is talking about a stock of more than 170,000 odd units, which could by the year end could go up to 200,000. But the problem is the speed at which these units are being consumed. And that's exactly what I was talking about. Delhi, NCR region still is looking at about 28 to 30,000 units in a year. I agree with Mohit, the last quarter, Q3 of the calendar, was better. However, that still is not good enough to actually conclude that we have jumped up our velocities, etc. Because as I understand, while the data is still awaited, but the festive season has gone pretty horrible. Sales at festive seasons haven't picked up. One of the reasons, as Mohit was talking about, was the home finance was also a bit in a tight spot. So overall, the quarter four of the calendar is going to be yet and again a disaster. So all likelihood is that we will still consume the same kind of numbers that we have been consuming in NCR for last 2-3 years, which is about 28,000 to 30,000 units.
Okay.
Which simply means that 100,000 units we're talking about is going to take at least 3.5 to 4 years, and that is the main concern. On the other side, your question about what's the frustration level or what are the levels of stresses out there in the market, whether a few of them really default on that, very tough to say, but still the likelihood of at least 10-15% of this inventory getting in that side where defaults may emerge in next quarter or two.
Okay, well, we'll have to leave it at that. Thank you very much for this very absorbing chat. Both of you somewhat disagreeing on the extent of the problem. Mohit believes that things should pan out, but Gulam is telling us what we heard from other experts, that another Amrapali is not ruled out if funds don't come by.
Oh yes, and the market's looking quite good. Still at the highest point.
Not just crossing 808, which was the first tick.
Yeah, perhaps a bit of a nitpicking there, Lata. But, you know, it's been a good series. Started at 10,000, now at 10,802. And the Bank Nifty slightly underperforming. Metals, Reliance, these are the kind of names that are doing well. Bajaj Finance as well. Ashwini Gujral, Mitesh Thakkar back with us. Rajat Bose is also with us. Ashwini, your thoughts on the first 45 minutes of trade and what's the trading call now?
Well, since yesterday we didn't get a big decline, based on that, the short covering also is not very huge. So if you are playing for the day, I think the gain is probably done or close to getting done. But if you are in this for the longer term, you can have a 100-150 point type stop, etc. Then there's no problem, you can continue to carry. But we have taken our short term positions off. Having said that, I think metals is really doing well, and you had 6-7 big down days on metals, so that way the risk reward is extremely comfortable. Tata Steel is a buy with a stop of 525, target of 550. Kotak is a buy with a stop of 1160, target of 1195. And RIL is a buy with a stop of 1160, target of 1200.
Okay. Well, just a word to our viewers. What you saw, pictures along with Ashwini's trades, are the launch of the Earth Observation Satellite and 30 smaller satellites from ISRO, by ISRO, from Sriharikota. Again, these are proud moments for us, and those are the scientists at ISRO monitoring the launch.
Well, that will happen in just, I think, moments from now. Satellites from 8 countries, including 23 from the US as well. According to ISRO, the Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle, Core Alone variant, will fly with the 380 kilo hyperspectral imaging satellite and 30 others together weighing over 260 kilos. The entire mission will be completed in just 112 minutes after the rocket's liftoff. Another feather in the cap for the space program, and another proud moment for India.
Something else also is on a rocket at this point.
The rupee?
That's the rupee, yeah. Yeah, it went to 69.98, and then I think it's now gained back to 70, but 69.99 as we speak.
Okay, sitting on that rocket and launching itself, perhaps. But let's go back to our technical guests and get some final calls in. Mitesh, hi, morning. Very good day so far. What are you buying? Is it the large caps?
See, I do like the entire spectrum in the sense that, you know, the first reaction I had was to book profits, but we have seen the market remain in expansion mode. So I think maybe, you know, we'll not have much of a decline. So we'll maintain a long bias, and the two stocks which I recommend right now would be Federal Bank, buy with a stop at 81.5 for targets of 88, and Dr. Reddy's, after a few days of consolidation post that positive news flow, is now showing good signs on the intraday chart. So that's a buy with a stop below 25.60. Look for targets of 26.90. And a word on rupee, if you permit. I think the rupee getting past 16.5 was a big event, because that was a level where it had topped out a couple of times previously. So that was a breakout level. If this entire decline of the rupee, you know, kind of stems around 16.5, then this entire move will be classified as pullback and we might again go into a depreciating mode. So I would be now watching the currency slightly closely for the next few days to come by.
Okay. Mitesh, just a word on Yes Bank. The low is 150. From there, a bit of a minor bounce. Is this any kind of trade for the day or you would want to avoid it?
Not yet, Anuj. I think still, like, I mean, the only good thing working in its favor possibly is that the stock is extremely oversold, but the indicator setup is still pointing towards downside. Maybe you'll have a few points of rally as a short covering kind of a thing, but I don't think there's a bigger reversal or an important reversal happening, you know, over here. So for the timing, avoid.
Okay. Well, Rajat Bose has also joined us. Good morning, Rajat. What are you trading now? I think Rajat is not able to...
Well, two stocks. One is Apollo Tyres. I would buy with a stop below 237.90.
Go ahead.
Can you hear me? Hello? Apollo Tyres, I would buy with a stop below 237.90. It has been on an uptrend and today also it showed some momentum. Probably 244 would be rich and that's the target that I have. And the other stock is Reliance, which I personally hold in my investment portfolio. And 1164 would be my stop loss and 1184 and 1189 are the two targets. It's actually a target for this week, that is up to Friday. And Reliance, I'm pretty bullish.
Gentlemen, thanks a lot for joining us and giving us the technical calls. But another stock that has been on our radar is HEG. It's seeing minor gains this morning, but it had a very sharp fall yesterday as some doubts were raised regarding the company's capex plans. As a backgrounder, last week HEG had announced an expansion of its graphite electrode capacity to 1 lakh tons per annum from 80,000 currently at a cost of 1,200 crores. Raju Rustogi, the CFO and CEO of HEG, joins us on the phone line. Mr. Rustogi, thanks so much for joining us. You know, same time last year at a conference call, HEG said that this capex plan would be for around 200 odd crores to raise your capacity. But this year, you've approved a resolution to raise the capacity with a cost of 1,200 crores. Why such a big dichotomy in the guidance and what was eventually announced?
Yeah, good morning. The conference call that you're referring to possibly seems to have omitted, or maybe the understanding was 200 crores per process. And in the conference call, it was clearly mentioned that our manufacturing process comprises of six stages of manufacturing. Now, so six stages, if we talk about 150 or 200 crores per process, comes to about 700, 800 crores at that time must have been the explanation.
Mm.
And then if you are talking about, say, the capex of 1,200 crores, let me highlight the gist of the entire capex. See, two things is we are putting up a dedicated nipple line. Now, what is a nipple is a connecting pin, which is the technology, the heart of the technology of graphite electrode making. Mm. Now, why it is important is it's a 60 kg piece holding 4 tons of material, 4 tons of electrode, one over the other. Now, this particular process takes 5 months in converting a raw material into finished product. So first time in the history of HEG Limited, like any other multinational graphite electrode manufacturing company, we are putting up a dedicated nipple manufacturing line, now, which was never part of any expansion in HEG in the past.
Okay.
The second part is, the HEG started in 1977, and as we mentioned in the investor conference call itself, that in the green plant, the first process of green extrusion itself, which was set up in 1977, it had a capacity of 80,000 tons.
Okay.
So in five subsequent expansion, which we did in every 10th year or 7th year in the past, it never included a green plant as a new expansion part of the capex cost.
Okay.
Now, this green itself incurs about 300 crores of capex,
okay,
the single one process.
All right.
And this we are doing first time after 40 years.
Okay, so got it, sir. You're starting from scratch. You put up a new plant from scratch almost is what you're telling us.
Yes.
And that increases about 20,000 tons, right?
Yes.
Okay. So now, since that, if the entire 20,000 has started production now, what is the likely revenue gain for the current year itself? And more importantly, of course, how does FY20 look for you in terms of a revenue increase?
See, 20,000 tons at the prevailing prices, if we take even $10,000 as some number, would amount to 1,400 crores per annum of revenue.
Okay, and this year you would get about 500, 600 crores at least?
No, see, the expansion is going to take about 2.5 years. So
we are starting today. Okay,
yeah.
Got it.
And this will get commissioned in about 30 months.
Right. So, how are you planning to fund this expansion, 1,200 crores?
See, we have about 1,400 crores of cash in our books.
Okay.
And if it is taking 2.5 years, we'll be generating further cash.
So no debt.
Our interest is to fund it totally from internal accruals.
Okay. So, you won't be increasing your debt at all?
Looks to be, we don't believe that we will be incurring any debt for this cash.
But what is the debt on the books right now?
It is zero, ma'am.
Okay. All right. Can you give us some idea of how graphite prices are moving and whether this $10,000 you're talking about is the visibility you have for the next few months?
See, graphite prices, we cannot disclose in specific numbers, but if I have assumed 10,000, definitely this is the price, or north of it is the price which we are assuming for subsequent 6 to 12 months.
Okay. On the buyback, can you tell us, will the promoters be participating in the buyback?
See, yes, they intend to participate, but that intention would officially be disclosed in the notice to shareholders. So, there is an intent definitely to participate.
Okay. So, that's a buyback of up to 13.6 lakh shares, right?
Yes, it is.
Yeah. How much may the promoters be interested in? Will there be something also available for other investors?
See, that I think is we have some time to decide on that, okay. But definitely the intent is there to participate.
Okay. When would we know?
I think in the next 10 days.
All right. Okay, Mr. Rastagi, thank you very much for joining us. Just a final question. Is the filmmaker Raju Hirani known to you?
Lata, you asked me this question 2 years
ago.
Yeah,
I forgot the answer. That's why I'm asking you again.
Yes, I was paid a royalty for using my name.
All right. Thank you very much. Mr. Rastagi, for joining us. Okay, well, we must get back to the reason why the markets are moving so high. Crude has fallen now to 58 and change, below 59 as well. So let's straight away head to Manisha Gupta to check out what are the early commodity trends in India. Good morning again, Manisha.
Morning, Lata, and thank you so much for that. Well, yes, the crude oil prices continue to see lower lows on the chart. Some bit of a buying in the Asian markets right now, but that doesn't do anything for the Indian space. With the rupee appreciating by nearly a percentage point, you would expect the calculations to be slightly softer into the Indian markets, and that's exactly what we are seeing. So keep aside the percentage in sense of the rupee, and then, of course, we have seen the crude oil prices come off from the kind of highs that we started. We started nearly a percentage point on the higher side in the Asian markets, but that seems to be getting mellow right now because Saudi Arabia has said that they would not cut output alone. They would want all OPEC members on. So that really leads you to the uncertainty into the 6th December OPEC meeting there. And then apart from that, you have the US inventories, which have increased by 14% in last many weeks. And that is putting pressure on the prices again. So every time you see a bit of a rebound after a sell-off in the New York session, that is getting sold off as well in the Asian markets right now. It is a lot of uncertainty. There's a lot of data still coming in. And the markets are looking at G20 and the OPEC meeting in the first week of December. Ahead of that, it is going to be very, very volatile crude oil prices going forward from you. The US dollar index has rebounded yet again. We are watching the US Fed statements. The equity markets are on the higher side, and that doesn't augur well for the precious metal prices. So gold and silver have seen a bit of a dip continuing there. It's trading at 3-week lows in the international gold markets, and it's a 3-month lows for the Indian gold prices, thanks to the rupee on what it has been doing. So we haven't been able to hold around that 30,500 mark for the Indian markets there. Some more deeper losses is what you are seeing in the spot space as well, as far as that goes. But physical buying has been supportive onto this profit taking. So there is some area of investors which actually is making use of this. The base metal prices, well, the New York session yesterday was good. We opened Shanghai on a positive note as well. But since then, there has been a bit of a decline. So 0.25% to 0.5% down on LME is how we are trading. And as I've been saying, it clearly is because of the Indian rupee that the kind of losses that we have seen in the global markets just turn more sharper for the Indian markets because of the rupee depreciation. So almost everything is trading in the red, starting with copper, aluminum. And we also have seen the steel prices trade very flat. So nickel and zinc prices also have come under some pressure, and the Indian market's taking cues from that. Trading strategies, though, are slightly on the buy call from the angel commodities. They have a buy in case of crude. 3,700 is the level that they're watching out for. They also have a buy continuing for nickel prices. 775 is the level to keep an eye on.
Okay, all buys coming in. Thanks, Manisha, for that. It's stable a state for our markets, equity markets as well. 10,800 has been conquered with ease.
Early morning tick was 10,808, and we just about touched it. We've not crossed that morning early morning high, although it's happened in the rupee and other. As you can see, you know, we are still running parallel. We are not getting past that 10,808, and I would watch that very closely. The rupee and the bond markets are reaching back to the early morning highs. We did see 7.6 on the bond yields and 69.99.98 on the dollar rupee as well.
Yeah.
So pretty much there the appreciation continued with some zigzag. But at the moment, we're going to discuss something more backward looking, and that is the back series of the GDP, which the government released for FY06 to FY12. This has handed some drastic cuts to the growth between FY06 and FY12. On an average, between 100 and 180 basis points is the cut in GDP that we have seen. Now, what this means is that for the period FY06 to FY12, whereas the Sudhita Mundal number and the previous numbers were giving an average of about 8.6 to 8.9, the new average is 6.9. And that's lower than the last 4 years, 2014 to 2018, which is 7.3. So it looks like the 2000s, the first decade, actually we grew slower than we are growing now. Ashima Goyal, member of the Prime Minister's Economic Advisory Council, and of course, a leading economist, joins us to discuss this. Ashima, does this come as a shock? Because was not the narrative that we grew fastest in our history in the 2000s, the first decade?
Yes, that is going to be a bit difficult for a lot of people to accept. We were a 9% plus 10, we touched 10, 11. Now it seems that our peak was 8.5. So, but on the whole, I think this is a little more credible, these numbers, the methodology. But we have to, I think, also realize that we should not give so much importance to GDP numbers, because they come out of a very complex process. And we need to take them with a pinch of salt.
No, it's we are trying to compare it with other you know, numbers, macro numbers. One, of course, is the Sensex EPS, and that will come up for you. The Sensex EPS from FY06 to FY12 grew at a compounded annual rate of about 11.9 to 12%. So basically, the Sensex EPS was about 500 in FY06, and it was 1,200 in FY12. But between FY14 and 18, it remained around 1,300. It remained flat. Does this strike as odd that if so many companies were growing their earnings at, you know, a 12% CAGR, that and they are not growing at all now, the earnings were flat from 14 to 12. Can there be such a big discrepancy between earnings growth and GDP numbers over such a long period?
Yes, that is true. At that time, it seemed as if a lot of things were really booming in the 2000s. But I think what happened was we had this huge infrastructure push investment. Mm. Another interesting thing to look at is what is happening to investment, because what we're seeing then is that investment is much lower now, capital formation ratios, but growth is much higher, which would imply that there's been a great increase in productivity. Mm. Yeah. But and that is also, you know, something we need to think about. But it is feasible in the sense that we have much more diversity in industry over the years, and much of the infrastructure investment was just stranded. Mm. So a lot of that investment was not really delivering GDP. Mm. So that could be a possible explanation.
Okay.
Ashima, I just wanted to know if this destroys the credibility of GDP number. Would really anyone care for the number that comes on November 30th?
No, I think that they have moved towards better practices, because there were a lot of assumptions and benchmarks and extrapolations in our GDP calculation, which is to be expected in a country with a very large informal sector, and which is undergoing a lot of change. So we should expect, we should look for improvements in the methodology. You know, like one major problem was the difference between CPI and WPI. Mm. You know, because there's such a wide gap between the two that if earlier they were using the WPI, that automatically led to higher rates of growth. Mm-hmm. Now they are using, the combination is used more correctly, the combination of CPI and WPI. Mm. So I think we should regard this as an improvement in practices. You're moving towards international practices in measurement. Mm. You're using much better data. For example, the huge growth in telecommunications, which you saw, which was just based on growth of numbers, you know, which is actually, a lot of them were duplicates and so on. Now it's based on minutes of usage, which is firmer, right? Mm. Mm. Much better, larger firm database, more robust on what is actually happening on the ground. So I think we should think that the GDP numbers coming in now are a little more reliable than the ones we were working with earlier.
Okay.
Said that in India, RBI governors don't just have, it's not that the future forecasts keep changing, but in India, the past also changes.
If I can just squeeze in one question, Ashima, good morning.
Good morning.
What is your expectation as far as the Q2 GDP is concerned? Because there is a viewpoint that it's going to slow down compared to the last few quarters because of a slowdown in rural demand. What are you penciling in? 7.5, 7.6?
About 7.5, yeah.
Okay. And what would the triggers be?
What would?
What is your 7.5 assumption based on?
Well, because there's been some slowdown in credit growth we've seen, and I think there was base effects which drove the rise in Q1. So because of that, we should expect it to come in slightly lower.
Okay. I want your word on what Jerome Powell said yesterday, and therefore the expectation that the number of rate hikes won't be so high. We've seen a significant impact on the rupee. The dollar became as cheap as 69.98, now 70 rupees. How do you see that as impacting the second half growth? Do you think that we could see a bump up?
Yes, I think this is all a very positive set of circumstances for India. Oil prices coming off and the rupee strengthening, which is going to reduce inflation and give more scope for a monetary accommodation. And in general, sentiments will improve. So we should see, although immediately after Q2, there would be some slowdown, but we might see some improvement after that. Yeah.
Okay. You know, monetary accommodation, unfortunately, is faced with the fact that only in the previous policy, they moved from neutral to calibrated tightening. Mm. So do you think it will take a policy more for the RBI to change that back to neutral? Is that a reasonable expectation?
Well, I think they say that they are data dependent, and this was a correction. Actually, some people were foreseeing this because there were sort of trends, long-term sort of softening in oil markets. But they took the view that the risks are going to continue. Mm. But if the data is showing something very different, I think they should adjust to the data and that the data now allows them to move to a different stance.
Oh, right. We should wait and see if they do that on December 5th itself, but more likely, I believe, that they'll do it in the next policy and wait it out. Thank you very much, Ashima Goyal, for joining us with your views on the backdated GDP as well as what the Jerome Powell statement has meant for India.
Well, the market has really picked up pace now. So it's almost a 90-point up move that you're seeing on the index and a 1% rally overall.
The best part is that the early morning high has been conquered now. Yeah. So that people who probably booked profit from 10,808 onwards down would now be wanting to jump back because the market is showing signs of being able to overcome. Now it is a trending upward market.
Yeah.
So it could be very good for a bull even if they bought in the morning. That's very, very positive. Up 0.8 at this point in time.
As we've been telling you, it is a trending market and the space that's really buzzing now is metals. Hindalco, Vedanta, Tata Steel, all up anywhere between 2.5% to 3% odd, making the market screen look very good. But as we wind down on Bazaar, we leave you with some comments from HDFC's Keki Mistry, who told CNBC that CNBC TV 18 that the liquidity situation in India has improved since the last couple of months. Mistry also expects the RBI to adopt a neutral stance in this policy. In fact, he was speaking to CNBC. So let's listen into that and thanks so much for watching.
Liquidity has been tight in India for a very long time, for almost a year. But the nervousness which was there in the market a couple of months ago, a significant part of that nervousness is gone. And that nervousness emanated because of one NBFC which failed, which was Island FS. And after that, there were a lot of reports about how some of the NBFCs had taken mismatches and had a very high leverage ratio. But all the commercial paper, which is the short-term borrowings which these companies had done, and all the commercial papers which matured from then till today have all got honored on time. So that has given a lot more confidence to the markets. The liquidity situation today is better, much better than what it was a couple of months ago. Yes, it could be even better, but it's a lot better than what it was a couple of months ago. With inflation under check, in my personal view, there is possibly even a possibility of even a rate cut, forget a rate hike. I think RBI will adopt a neutral stance. I don't think there'll be any change in rates, but I would not completely rule out the possibility of a rate cut. Though I would say that the chances of that happening are relatively low, but I would not completely rule it out. The fate of the rupee, the performance of the rupee is very closely linked to two factors. One is what happens in the US and the other is oil prices. So the sharp spurt that we saw in oil prices a couple of months ago is what caused the rupee to weaken sharply and this sharp depreciation to 73.50 levels. But over the last 2 or 3 weeks, with oil prices subsiding, you have seen the rupee also come away. So to my mind, the rupee will settle between 70 and 72, somewhere in that range, with a medium-term view.